Hey guys, welcome to Silk 201. Today we're going to talk about what is linguistics, what are we even studying? Ready? So the first thing that I want to talk about is prescriptivism versus descriptivism. So the doctor brings you, or gives you, writes a prescription, and you go to the Walgreens or you go to CVS or wherever you go, Target, Walmart, to fill your prescription, and then you probably take half of, or three-fourths of it, and then you feel better, and then you're like, okay, well. So how many of us actually take the whole thing? Well, I would be one of those people that I follow the rules like that, but most people don't do that. My husband never takes the whole thing. So if you think about language the same way, you can realize that prescriptivism is the rules that you're supposed to follow depending on, I don't know, depending on who makes up the rules. Somebody way back when. So prescriptivism focuses on elevating one language variety above all others, whether it be British English or Argentine Spanish or whatever, and it has to be a certain way that you speak it, right? But when you look at descriptivism, that's like looking at what reality is, analyzing and describing how a language is used, is actually used by a speech community. So that's why if you're studying a second language, or even your first language, if you go into a different community and people are speaking differently, maybe you don't understand what they're saying. Descriptivism is watching that and not judging, just describing what language is used versus prescribing. Prescriptivism implies all other forms are incorrect, improper, it's just wrong, I don't know why it's wrong, but it is. And descriptivism observes the language as it is not making that judgment. Gather data, find patterns, and other aspects of prescriptivism, linguistic purism, there's only one right way. So all of these include grammar, semantics, pronunciation, syntax, spelling, which is what we're going to be studying. So grammar would be prescriptivist grammar is you're supposed to never put a preposition at the end of the sentence. So if I say, where are you at? The at is not really supposed to be there. So prescriptivists would say, where are you? Versus descriptive, which is what 95% of the people say, where are you at? Which I never used to say that, but now it's pretty common. Semantics, let me think of an example. My son says, Mom, I'm gonna go kick it with my friends. Kick it, okay. Prescriptively, that should mean you're going to kick the ball. But descriptively, I know that he's saying, I'm just going to go hang out with my friends. Pronunciation, the way that you pronounce certain words. Prescriptively, you're supposed to say pen and pin are two different words. Pen that you write with and a pin like a lapel. But I have a really hard time with that because I'm a Southerner. So there's no difference for me. Syntax, think about Yoda. So if I say, have a good day, that's prescriptive. Yoda would say, good day you have, right? And then spelling, which I'll get into more once we get to the next topic. Okay, a little bit more about it. We have this little guy here. Skirt. I usually don't say it right, but my kids tell me how to say things, and I try. Because I'm a linguist, I'm objective, I try. So linguistics is scientific. It's a scientific study. I'm being objective. I'm assuming a theoretical framework. Direct observation of skirt, for example, and empirically verifiable. So I can show evidence that I found this little guy when doing a Google search for skirt. Yeah? So there's evidence, and there's probably, I don't know how many other images there. And so basically just remember that it's a science. It's not a pseudoscience. It is scientific. Okay. Linguists also look at how language relates to social factors like race or class. That's sociolinguistics. So for example, you see this meme here, and he says, yeah, that's going to be a no for me, dog. So the dog might be used to mean a certain thing in within a certain speech community, right? But others might not really understand what he's saying. How language is acquired, language acquisition and second language acquisition, that linguists look at that as well, and the differences and the similarities. How our brain processes and stores language, neurolinguistics. So what I'm thinking right now, and then it comes out of my mouth, I'm pronouncing the words, they're coming out. You probably get most of what I'm saying. That's all neurolinguistics, because then you hear the word, it goes into your brain, and it processes. And how languages change, historical linguistics. So maybe a long time ago, dog meant something else, and now it actually means, like, bro, which bro, bruh, used to mean something else, right? Okay, and even how languages die, so linguists look at how languages die. You may not be able to see this very well, but this is a map of the world, and it's showing the areas with languages near extinction. And so a lot of these languages are dying. So you have the threat level, dark red's extreme, then severe, orange is high, medium, and then yellow is low. So the most severe would be this Eastern Siberia, 9 language families that are dying, right? And we also talk about, is that bad? Maybe not. Some people are strong proponents for keeping a language at all costs. Others say, well, that's just what happens. So what are we going to look at in this course? We're going to start from the middle and go up or down, however you want to see it. So we start with phonetics and phonology. Then we go to morphology, syntax, then semantics, and then pragmatic. So I want to talk a little bit about each one so that you have some idea of what it is we're even looking at here, okay? So everybody has a cell phone, right? Most cell phones are smart phones. They're smarter than I am. They tell me, you know, 12 minutes to get to work or whatever when I get in the car. Or depending on the time of day, it'll take you 15 minutes to get to the school where your kids are. So the first thing that we'll look at next week is phonetics and phonology. So phonetics is a study of the theory of sounds, and phonology is what we actually do with that. So phonetics would be for lol, laugh, out, loud, right? LOL, and now it's become LOL, right? Because that's easier to just type that. And that ended up becoming a phonological practice of lol, which when I first heard that, I was like, that's weird. And now LOL actually has even changed meaning, so, or lol, sorry. Also, the theory, which would be phonetics, would be, what are you doing? Who speaks like that? That's what you learn, for example, in a second language classroom, how to enunciate every word, but nobody talks like that when you actually go with native speakers. What you doing? So that would be phonology. I love phonology. Morphology and syntax. So let's talk about morphology. Lol comes from laugh out loud. So you could add something to laugh. You could say, I laughed out loud, which is kind of weird. You could say, I'm laughing out loud. So I'll give you an example of my daughter, Layla, who's 9. She does Musical.ly, which is an app on the phone, and she makes these 15-second little clips, or I don't know how long they are. And she has all the moves down, and she does the... I don't even know what she does. So she has turned Musical.ly, which is a noun, into a verb. She says, either I'm doing Musical.ly, or I Musical.ly'd. I am Musical.ly-ing. Yeah, how did she know how to do that? That's morphology. You add, you take parts of words and add them to other words, and you create new words. Or you create make it a different part of speech. That's Musical.ly-able. Maybe you could do that. Okay, and then what you doing? What are you doing? I think I'm going to talk to you about syntax with that one. So syntax is the order of words. Syntax is changes depending on what the language is, and it is subject, object, verb. No, it's subject, verb, object in English. But because this is a question, you switch the order, the syntax. So the order is, what are you doing, instead of, you are doing what? Okay, think about that for a little bit. Now we have semantics. Lol, if I said that to my husband, he probably would think I'm taking something, or I don't know. He wouldn't get it. He's kind of not really part of that speech community. He does text, but sometimes I don't really know what he's saying. And if I text him, I never really know if he actually reads the text or he just calls me. And okay, because that's easier to talk to me. So a lot of people might not know what lol means, or it might mean something different for other people. I was saying that lol has changed meaning. So it used to be laugh out loud, and now it's almost like a connective, you know, I get you. I know what I, you know, I hear you type of thing. What you doing? Again, maybe semantically that would be different, no? For somebody who is not within a certain speech community, that, no? Okay. And then pragmatics. Pragmatics would be like, well, who do you use this with? In what situation? Do you go up to your professor and say, lol? No, probably not, unless it's me, and then most people do say all kinds of stuff to me. But, or what you doing? If you write me an email and you say, what you doing? I probably, hey, Anne, what you doing? That would be a little bit weird, but, you know, you could try it. I would just be objective and say, interesting. This person just not follow this particular register or pattern that other students follow, right? Okay, so what? So why are we talking about this? I love it. It's interesting. We use language all the time, every day. Every time you pick up your cell phone, you're texting, you're reading, you're scrolling, you're looking. It's language. See you next time.